I'm glad that Thomas was able to be with us this morning. So powerful. So powerful to hear his experiences after Jesus' death. As he said, he's most often been known as the doubter. But I'm wondering, was that a doubter we saw today? Is that title really fair? What do you think? Did he demonstrate doubt or faith or both? You know, it's really hard to imagine what it was like for the disciples after Jesus' death, the fear that they must have felt as they cowered in that room together. The confusion, the not knowing what to do next or where to turn. Their teacher and leader, the one who had held them together for months, now gone, buried, dead. And with that, all their hopes and all their dreams, all the thoughts that they had about what they were going to do together, locked. Locked inside a tomb, or so they thought. They must have been left with this overwhelming sense of failure, of loss and shame, because they knew that they had deserted Jesus in his hour of need. You know, I wonder if they were more disappointed and disillusioned with themselves or with Jesus, who had raised their hopes so high. And then, in the midst of all this, Mary Magdalene came excitedly to tell them the news that just didn't make sense. She had actually seen Jesus and talked to him. Jesus was alive. He had been risen from the dead, just as he promised. Could it be so? How could it be? You know what? They just didn't believe Mary's words. Of course, they didn't believe Mary's words because she was a woman. And well, you know about women. Women aren't rational thinkers. Those men, all 10 of them locked in that room, were doubters. They were so fearful that they didn't even rush to the tomb to check it out. They were afraid they might be seen, afraid of what might happen to them. They just stayed put and waited. I wonder how long they would have just waited, cowering in that room, if the next thing had not happened. Because to their surprise, astonishingly, quietly, he was there, right there in their midst. Even though the door was barred, there he stood, right before their eyes. Jesus was alive. Hey, Mary Magdalene must have been right about this. I wonder if maybe just for a moment, some of those disciples might have been a little afraid. Hi, Jesus. You know, maybe they were afraid that Jesus might be angry, understandably, for they had abandoned him. And in Peter's case, he had even denied him, not once, but three times. It's frightening enough to think about seeing someone who's dead suddenly alive. But they know that he has every reason to say, "Where were you when I needed you?" What kind of faithful disciples are you anyway? How did you run out on me? Peter, especially you. I picked you out to be the leader. How could you have denied me three times? But no, that's not what happened. You know, there were no accusations. even an expression of disappointment or hurt. Actually, the first words Jesus offered were a gift. Peace be with you. He knew what was in their hearts. He knew why they had barred that door. After offering them peace, he showed them his hands and his feet. And they recognized him and they rejoiced. And then he offered them the gift of the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the one who would remain with them. He didn't just give it to them. He breathed the Spirit into them. In the Gospel of John, this is his Pentecost. Here the Spirit comes not with wind and flame like we read in Acts, but with Jesus' own breath, the life force of the one raised from the dead, who then told them to go out and be peace and forgiveness and love for the world. Just as God sent Jesus, so Jesus sent them into the world. And in our gospel reading, quickly, the gospel lesson turns to Thomas. Thomas, who we saw here today. Thomas, who must have been hiding somewhere else. Or maybe he was really the brave one, the one that they had sent out on an errand. Hey, go find us some food. Because the others were just too afraid. For whatever reason, Thomas missed that whole experience. When he returned, the disciples anxiously told him what he had just missed. And I can imagine Thomas saying, oh yeah. When are you going to say April Fools? Understandably, he had some doubts. He said, unless I see the nail marks, I'm not going to believe. All I was asking for was the same assurance the other disciples had received. Does that make him the doubter? I think we can all imagine why Thomas had doubts. When faced with the unbelievable, it's only natural to have doubts. There's a story of three accountants who were traveling by train to a conference, and they were with their three engineer friends. Now, the three accountants bought three train tickets, but the engineers, three of them, bought one ticket. Hey, how are you three engineers going to travel by only one ticket? Said the accountants. You doubt that we can do this? Said the engineers. Well, just watch and see. So they all boarded the train. The accountants took their seats, but the three engineers crammed themselves into a restroom and closed the door behind them. Soon the conductor came through the car asking for the tickets. He knocked on the restroom door and said, ticket please. The door opened a crack and a single arm emerged with the ticket in hand. The conductor took it and moved on. The accountants agreed. This was really rather a clever idea. Way to save money, and you know, so after the conference, they decided to duplicate the engineer's feat. They walked up to the ticket counter and they said, one ticket, please. But they were astonished when their engineer friends bought no ticket at all this time. Hey, how possibly can three of you travel without any ticket? The accountants asked. You doubt that we can do this? Said the engineers, just watch and you'll see, replied the engineers. So the accountants rammed into a restroom with their one ticket, just as the engineers had done before. And across the hallway, the three engineers also crammed into a restroom. As soon as the train left the station, one of the engineers left his restroom, walked across the hall, knocked on the door where the accountants were hiding, and said, ticket, please. It's easy to doubt. same proof countless pilgrims after him have echoed, "Show me, and I'll believe." The gospel story tells us that it was a week later, before Jesus returned to see the disciples. We can only imagine what that week must really have been like for Thomas. I'm sure he was feeling the same things that many who have doubts feel. He was feeling alienation from his friends, not just alienation from what he believed, but alienation from those who had been his support system. He was suddenly an outsider. We've all been an outsider before. The truth is that in those times, we need community more than ever. But the reality is, that's when we tend to avoid it. As Jesus returned to see Thomas and the others, he appeared as dramatically as he did at first when he met those ten. He offered Thomas the same words, kind of ironic, "Peace be with you." Ironic because Thomas must have been feeling anything but peace at that moment. Jesus knew what Thomas needed. He knew that he needed that tactile evidence, the proof of him as living and risen. You know, we don't know from Scripture whether Thomas really did touch and feel, because Scriptures tell us that immediately he responded with that very powerful profession of faith that we heard. We heard it here today. "My Lord and my God." You know, that is the first profession of faith. "My Lord and my God." Those other 10 disciples didn't express that profession of faith. Thomas did. Are those the words of a doubter? Is Thomas maybe the faithful one? Many of us who call ourselves disciples encounter times of doubt. It all seems unbelievable. We may even pull ourselves away from the church, our support system, our community. But you know what? It's in those times that we need our community of faith even more to support us and walk with us through our questions. There's no better place to bring your questions. One week after our beautiful Easter services, when it seems as if life is just back to normal, back to our lives with doubts, with threats of terrorism, global warming, whatever that weather was yesterday, economic problems, wars that never end, and an election season that puts our nation to shame. And of course, we all come with our own private griefs and burdens. Health problems, kid problems, too much work, no work, too much worry, too much coming at us. Too much to run away from. So much to fear. What's a person to do? Tell you that whatever overwhelms us on any post-Easter morning, and boy, we sang that song today, I love it. Every morning is Easter morning from now on. Every day is Resurrection Day. God comes to us in the midst of our fears and says, you know what? "Peace be with you." God says to us, "Peace be with you." Whatever doubts churn in our mind, whatever sins trouble our conscience, whatever pain and worry binds us up, whatever walls we have put up or doors we have locked securely, God comes to us and says, "Peace be with you." That's what he says. Say it again.
Peace be with you.
Whatever hunger and need we feel deep in our souls, God calls us to the table. God calls us here to be fed and then to be sent out into the world. To be justice and peace, to be salt and light, to be hope, hope for the world. We can do it. If we keep our eyes open, our minds slumber, our hearts soft, and willing to love. For we ourselves have been overwhelmed by the love of God. As God sent Jesus, God sends us too today. Each one of us, no matter who we are or where we are in life's journey, we are sent to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to the world.